Hello, and thanks for joining us for the 2021 Repro Film Fest. I'm Mallory Martin.
I'm Debbie Samples.
And I'm Leela Med O'Connor, and we are the founders of Repro Film Fest. Whether you're returning or are joining us for the first time this year, we are so grateful that you're with us. Through knowledge, intention, and action, Repro is the only film festival in the world dedicated to reproductive justice, advocating for women's, cis, trans, and non-binary inclusive, reproductive healthcare, justice, and bodily autonomy.
And we welcome you to one of our newest Repro special events, the Yoni Hour. To open this year's festival, we are beyond thrilled to introduce you to the newest members of the Repro family, the Women of Tomorrow, Tony-nominated Broadway star Laura Bell Bundy and her best friend, singer, songwriter, and producer, Shea Carter. Together, they have created a podcast and album of the same name and are using their platform to explore issues women are facing today. They will also be hosting a Repro Film Fest filmmaker, Susan O'Brien, to discuss her film, Resist, the Resistance Revival Chorus. So stay tuned on more information on that. This Yoni Hour, Laura and Shea get real about some of their own personal experiences with the vast and complex world of reproductive health and the insane history behind how we ended up where we are today.
Our hope for Repro Film Fest 2021 is to inspire women and men to gain a better understanding about what reproductive justice really means, and to recognize that the future of reproductive justice lies in our hands. We celebrate that for the first time in history, our second in command has a uterus, honor the legendary work of heroes like Ruth Bader Ginsburg and all of our partner organizations, and proudly present the stories told by all of our women filmmakers. But we must also recognize that the threat to women's bodily autonomy remains constant, both here in the US and around the world. And in order to establish a more equitable future for generations to come, we must take action now.
When you purchase and donate to Repro, you have become an active participant of change, as all net ticket sales support our three beneficiary organizations. You can access our films from anywhere in the United States. Get all the info at reprofilmfest.com. Without further ado, take it away, Laura and Shay.
Hello, and welcome to the Repro Film Fest Yoni Hour. I'm Laura Bell Bundy, and I'm joined by my Women of Tomorrow album co-writer and podcast co-host, Shea Carter.
Hi, I'm Shea Carter. I'm so happy to be here.
And for those unfamiliar with the term Yoni, it's a Sanskrit word that translates to the female organs of generation, and it's a symbol of our divine procreative energy. So look for more Yoni hours during the upcoming Repro Film Fest, August 9th to 18th, 2021. Before we get started, it is worth noting that while we will be covering serious topics during this conversation, we want to celebrate the fact that we have a space to talk about these issues. So if you don't have one already, grab your favorite happy hour beverage and, you know, your Yoni egg if you want, and meet us back here.
And as many of you know, Repro Film Fest is the only festival in the world dedicated to reproductive justice and advocating for women's reproductive health care and bodily autonomy. So we'd like to thank the Repro team for creating this space where we can have these discussions in a productive and safe environment.
Definitely. So this conversation today, we are going to be talking about our reproductive health and our reproductive history, and do so in a personal way where we're talking about our personal experiences with our reproductive organs and sort of the some of the stigma that has come with the female reproductive system over time and generations throughout history, and how that actually affects us today, and some of the issues that we're currently dealing with when it comes to laws being made about our bodies.
And because we are a product of women's fertility and women having reproductive rights, thank God my mother had this, I feel like we should start by like letting people know our own journeys. And I know, Laura, you've had a really interesting journey with fertility. You did IVF. And for those of you who don't know, it's in vitro fertilization. And I was wondering, when did you first realize that you were having issues with fertility?
So it's interesting that the reproductive organs are the center of health for women. And when we have something that isn't normal, that's an indication that something is off internally in our bodies. And I never had regular periods my entire life until I got into my 30s. And I think a lot of that had to do with my diet, what I was eating, my stress levels, the high level of exercising that I was doing in terms of doing Broadway shows, and you know, a number of those issues. But it began to regulate a little bit as I got older. But that should have been an indication that something was going on hormonally with me. And when I was in my mid to late 30s, it was time for me to have a child. And of course, I think a lot of women go through this experience right now. I know you have too, where we are career women who have a list of things that we'd like to accomplish before we have children. And our sense of autonomy and independence and financial independence is so important to us prior to having a child. And this idea of like, yes, we can go out and we can do it all. Is that real? Is that an illusion? And I believe that freezing our eggs allows us to maybe keep that dream alive.
Preach on.
and so I was in this position where I was, you know, I had finally accomplished these things. It felt that the timing was right to begin to try to have a child. And then it wasn't working. I did not have a normal 28-day cycle. I had more of like a 32 to 35 day cycle. I didn't have 12 periods a year. I had 11. And so to try to figure out like when I was ovulating and try to have a child, yeah, and it was not working. So I tried for a year and then eventually began to seek help. Now, something
and
that-
did this come as such a shock to you? Because I think for so long, I know when I was young, I was like, I'm going to get pregnant. I'm so afraid of getting pregnant. I'm sure I could get pregnant at any minute. So then to know that you were having an issue with getting pregnant, were you like surprised by that? Being so young and healthy.
Getting pregnant is so polarizing. It's like the worst thing that can happen to you at one point, and then it's the best thing that can happen to you. And there's not a lot of people that experience the in-between that are like, all right, you know, it's like, you know, this miraculous thing on one end, or it's this horrifying thing on another, depending on what your age is and where you are in your
situation. Yeah.
And you know, I should have known that there was something going on because I had gone to, I had felt pain. These moments, I would feel this weird pain, especially during sex and during, you know, certain moments that in my reproductive area, and I didn't know what that was.
Your whole life?
No, in my late 20s and early 30s, I started to feel this thing that would come up. And it was like a debilitating pain. It wasn't necessarily cramps during my period, which by the way, like a lot of pain during cramping is not normal. You need to investigate that as well and make sure that everything is cool. So I had endometriosis, but it was not officially diagnosed until I was going through IVF. And here's the thing that is so crazy. And we've talked about this before on the podcast in regards to fertility.
We have a podcast called Women of Tomorrow. And that's the podcast you can check out and hear this other episode. But continue,
we're
going to
be putting this entire thing on the podcast in case you want to check it. So, you know, what's interesting and is what we talked with Calais Stewart on the podcast about a number of episodes ago was what's crazy is that we shouldn't be finding out these things going on in our bodies when we realize that getting pregnant isn't working. Right? We should know earlier and be able to solve them. They should be an indication of our health overall. So I had endometriosis and wasn't diagnosed until the fertility doctor was like, oh, you have endometriosis. Learned that in the first 5 seconds of being in an ultrasound with a fertility doctor. And I was like, that would make sense.
But I've never had a gynecology appointment where they did an ultrasound.
You come in and you get the pap smear and it's like, they charge your insurance and, you know, it's like, get that money, honey, moving on. Right. And some of those things we're not talking about unless you really have like this holistic approach to the female body and the health and all of that. So, you know, at the time, you know, here I was very eager to have a child and I'm like, all right, so what are my options? And my husband and I just decided to go ahead with the IVF because we wanted to have more than one child and we didn't want to have them right in a row. And so being able to have embryos that we could use several years later, that idea appealed to us and appealed to me. And And so I went ahead with the IVF process, and I had a very successful journey there, guided and helped by an acupuncturist who is, you know, my person, and eating a diet that was low in sugar and no gluten and dairy. And I think that I handled some of the hormonal treatments better because of the clean diet. And I have a beautiful 2-year-old little boy. But, you know, these are the things that we go through. And then I still have endometriosis. So, you know, if I want another child, and it's funny because my husband and I lately, literally for the last year, we've been having unprotected sex and I have not gotten pregnant. So, oh, something else I wanted to mention is when I went through the IVF process, I'm at the right, you know, like we're going to put the embryo in, but we have to do this test first to make sure that the cervix is clear and, you know, the fallopian tubes and everything looks clear. And when they went up for that test with me, they found a polyp, which is what, you know, my friend Hutchie joked was nature's IUD the whole time. And what's interesting is that wasn't the first thing they tested. Right? Shouldn't that have been in the beginning of the process before even freezing my eggs? Like, oh, if we remove this polyp, you might be able to get pregnant. So I still don't know, you know, how that affected. But again, we don't check these things. We're not checking these things on a regular basis.
Yeah, we're not really proactive about our health. And then so women are forced into this position where they don't know until they're failing at it. And then the shame in fertility and in infertility is just, also, that adds to your stress level, which is going to make you more infertile. It's sort of this vicious cycle. I'm curious. So after they do the insemination, how long did it take you to find out you were pregnant?
So it's about, I want to say 10 days.
It took the first time, right?
It did. I was very fortunate.
Very fortunate. Okay. So sorry. It took about 10 days. Uh-huh.
It took about 10 days to 2 weeks. They don't want you to take a pregnancy test, so you come in the office and find out, but I did anyway. I think a lot of women do. We're like,
how could you not? That's yeah, that amount of self-control. That's unnatural.
I would know by the 10th day. I'm going to check it out. So I did, and I remember it was the day after my friend Tracy J's wedding, and we were staying at a hotel, and, you know, I peed on my APT and was like, you know, running around screaming and being worried the baby was going to drop out if I ran around too much, you know.
Lay it down, put your feet up, hold it in, squeeze the yoni egg. One thing that brings up for me, you know, with women's bodily autonomy being such a point of contention for years and years, and especially right now, there's these new abortion laws in Texas, which make it, I think it's like a 6-week abortion law. Well, 6 weeks of, you don't even know you're pregnant yet. It took you, who's looking for it, who's waiting for it, 5 weeks. So Right. Gosh, what an overwhelming ask of women to know that they're pregnant within this tiny margin, or abortion is illegal, even in cases of rape and incest now in Texas, which, I mean, to get really deep quick, just hearing about, you know, how long it took you waiting on pins and needles to find out, because you're so excited about being pregnant that.
So here's the thing. And just to break down that timeline and how the 6 weeks is a really unrealistic when it comes to knowing that you may be pregnant. They will say you're 5 weeks pregnant, but that 5 weeks is from your last period, not from the actual embryo being created within the body. So for me, I when I found out I was pregnant, I was five and a half weeks. But that was because my ovulation took place 18 to 20 days into my cycle. I was inseminated, had to wait 10 to 12 days, then took the test. So the thing is, it's about the hormone, that the pregnancy test is picking up on a hormone we have in our bodies when we are pregnant, HCG.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's not detected in an early pregnancy test.
I have a lot of friends who took pregnancy tests, were pregnant, but they got a negative because there wasn't a lot of HCG picked up on the test, because some of it is like they didn't take it in the morning, they took it in the afternoon after a lot of water. Like, and the thing is, the more that hormone that comes in to the body, that's when we start to experience the morning sickness, which, by the way, is not in the morning, it's all day long. I don't know why that's called that.
How that rumor got started.
All day long. And that, for me, that didn't happen until I was around 8 to 10 weeks pregnant. So if you are not aware, if your cycle is irregular, if you don't have periods every month, if you ovulate in a time that is unpredictable, like I did, and my cycle wasn't a normal 28-day cycle, from the beginning of my period to the next period was almost 6 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So someone like me wouldn't
even know.
Wouldn't have 6 weeks to know, you know, unless I knew I had done IVF, and so I was checking.
Yeah.
Right. But
this is so complicated and complex and changing from person to person, and the variants are so massive that to expect people to understand their own body, much less someone else's body, enough to go into a polling place and decide that they should be able to regulate somebody else's experience when the information is vast and we don't have access to it. I'm a woman and I hardly understand what's happening with my reproductive system. I just found out the other day, I tried to make a gynecology appointment for a pap smear, and because I had one last year, my insurance won't cover it. They're only covering pap smears every 3 years. Even though we have HPV running rampant, which leads to cervical cancer. I unfortunately had a girlfriend pass away at 27 from cervical cancer. And it's like, you know, the access to information then makes us really ignorant in terms of being able to make, you know, vote in the proper ways, make these decisions. And so I think right now I want us to do a little history lesson, because I feel like we don't know where we are going until we know where we've been and we see the warning signs. So I know you are a huge history buff, and I don't want to butcher this history on the Comstock laws that you have so down. So please enlighten us.
Well, it's interesting. You know, women, here's the thing that's so interesting about this is I'm telling you now, in this modern age, the things I didn't know about my body. And you are telling me the same. And our lack of education around the female reproductive system is staggering. And some of that is because the female reproductive system was considered obscene. To say the word vagina was like, it's a technical term, guys. Mm-hmm. It's like heart or liver, vagina, you know, and it's yet, ooh, we got to say, hoo-ha, you know, or something like, you know, that our mom,
yeah,
you know,
it's like, shameful.
Lady parts, you know, whatever. And so this sort of stigma around this being like bad or negative sort of is to blame really for us having this lack of information about our beautiful bodies that birth the human race. I mean, this is the most sacred and beautiful thing that happens, and we get to do that. And yet we have very limited information about it unless we go search for it. And so our education about women's bodies really needs to happen. I feel like it should happen in the educational system. I feel like mothers and daughters, they do their best to talk about it, but there's some people that don't have, you know, moms to talk about it with. And so we need to be better at getting this information out to all women and to men, especially if decisions being made about women's bodies are happening by men. Okay, so I'm going to go back and talk about the Comstock laws. So back in, I want to say it was 1873, the Comstock laws took place, which is that birth control was illegal. Talking about birth control was illegal. The reproductive system, talking about any of that in a printed material sent in the mail was considered illegal. And Margaret Sanger, who is a controversial figure, but is also the founder of the Center for Reproductive Rights, which eventually became Planned Parenthood. She, in the early 1900s, created a pamphlet on the women's bodies for women to understand how their reproductive system worked and how to prevent pregnancy and how to enjoy sex, and explained what everything was. You know, your vulva is mm-hmm. different from your vagina, is different from your clitoris, which is different from your cervix, and here's your ovaries, and here's your uterus, and this is how it all works. And she printed these pamphlets, and she would talk about, you know, you're ovulating at this time of month and this, and here are the things that you can do and this. And she was arrested. And she was charged with, I think, over 20 years for this, because it was considered profanity. And really, you know, she was talking about it on the town hall stage in New York City. And she was arrested from the stage, taken through the town hall, and the women were singing "We Shall Overcome" as she was walking down. And what's interesting is that our album that we made, it, to me, became inspired by the event that I did at the town hall to raise money for women's rights and health back in 2017. And in that exact same place, it was almost 100 years to the day of that event. Oh.
And she would have gotten 20 years in jail had she not fled, yeah, to she Europe. Fled to Europe. Like, she would be in jail for 20 years for just teaching women about their reproductive, yes, system.
And when she was there, she studied with different sex psychologists and things to understand more, because for her, there were two sects of thinking at that time, that a woman's right to vote was going to give women the most power. And she believed that a woman's understanding of their body and the ability to plan a family was going to give her the most freedom and the most power. And I believe that you see, you know, when you look back at our history as women and our modernization as women and our independence and our financial independence, this big sea change for us happened in the 70s. And that is when birth control became illegal mm-hmm. for single women in, want to say it was 1973. And that's when you saw this sort of huge surge of women going to university. Then you see in the 80s, this big surge of women that are getting out of that universities, going into the workplace. And then we sort of have this natural evolution of where we are today as a result of birth control, mm-hmm. of the understanding of how our bodies work and the ability to plan a family and to have autonomy about our bodies. And you also know, not only as a result of birth control, I also mean a Roe v. Wade decision was made during that time, mm-hmm. as well. So this sort of sense of reproductive freedom and our autonomy over our body has created independence and freedom and financial wealth for us.
Well, it has also saved a ton of lives. Like, before Roe v. Wade, I think we were losing 5,000 women a year that we knew about every year that was dying from abortions. And then that effectively ended when Roe v. Wade happened and we made them legal. When you make abortions illegal, there's approximately like 68,000 women each year that die from unsafe abortions. Women are never going to stop having abortions. They're just going to stop having safe ones.
That is true. I had an interview with Barbara Boxer, and she said that we're not going to stop women from having abortions. We're just going to not be able to save their lives, you know? And so that's what's really difficult about it. And so I want to talk about something else when it comes to the history of abortion and contraception. Abortion was considered legal in the beginning of our country's foundings when the Puritans came over. And it was it wasn't just legal. It was safe. It was condoned. And it was a practice procedure.
By the Puritans. The Puritans decided this is right. We're going to keep this going.
And so, but the difference is, so it wasn't a 6-week deadline for them. It was, it could happen before the quickening. And the quickening is when from 14 to 26 weeks where you can feel a kick, you know, and how these abortions were done was not a surgical procedure. It was through midwifery and holistic medicine, mostly women who had this knowledge passed down years and years and years, ancient medicine of herbs and tinctures that would eliminate a pregnancy. And so this was always safe. You know, it was like, we're going to take this little tincture and these things. And, you know, it was probably very private as well. And
So I think there's an important thing to see in all of this is always ask, what is the reason people want control over women? What is the reason why people are caring if that woman has an abortion because she was raped? What is the reason? So it's like when you really are looking at this history, instead of just assuming it's this morality clause, ask the questions, because a lot of things were changing at this same time in modern medicine, where medicine was really kind of, you know, women's intuitive medicine. We were holistic. We were using the use of herbs. And you look at all of these ancient traditions and then you see the male white Western doctors that are now creating a business in medicine that is going to undercut all of this. So there's so many different levels, varying levels of why having control over women's bodies, having control over women's lives, keeping an American woman's job as wife and mother being the predominant role for all women in America, because that leaves more room for men.
Well, I think we need to talk about the specifics in this.
Well, yeah. So, Sarah Grosvenor, is that the girl who was like, I think this is in 18th century America. A young woman died from a late term surgical abortion in Connecticut. It was in 1742. And surgical abortions were rare and dangerous back then. And most abortions in this period, you know, were the herbal things that we were just talking about. But in Sarah's case, there's this whole legal record and the doctor got accused of murdering the young woman and the unborn child. And so this started kind of bringing up more sensitivity this seemed more extreme. And so that's, I think, one of the biggest shifts in changing how we started to see abortions, that even though it was like very normalized before.
And also want to really point out from the beginning of the founding of our country, Puritans coming over through the Declaration of Independence, abortion was not, there were no laws against it until the 1860s, and they weren't everywhere, and they had to do with between 14 and 23 weeks, the quickening. It was a misdemeanor to have an abortion. Now that was because of surgical procedures, and not because of the herbs and the midwifery. But I want to talk about the invention of science and scientific procedures in medicine that had to do with surgical procedures, and that these were male dominated fields, and midwifery and holistic medicine were female dominated fields. And so there was this campaign to criminalize abortion because of this growing, the American physicians, male physicians, they began to battle these irregular doctors, like, you know, to find their way and to make their way into medicine. And because these irregular doctors, like midwives and homeopaths, would give herbal remedies for abortion, they began to villainize this.
Yeah. And villainize is the exact word. You have to create a villain, and capitalism always needs a villain.
So together, a coalition of male doctors backed by the American Medical Association and the Catholic Church and a sensationalist newspaper began to campaign for the criminalization of abortion. And you guys, that's how it happened.
That's how it happened.
amazing article that it's called, it's from AmericanProgress.org. It is called Scarlet Letters, Getting the History of Abortion and Contraception Right. And I highly recommend that you take a look at
and read the entire thing. So much wonderful information.
Really fascinating about sort of the way that we had healthcare prior, that sea change of Western medicine, and how women's bodies were all sort of wrapped up into that. And one interesting fact that I wanted to bring up that I forgot about was because birth control, any form, was considered illegal. It wasn't just a birth control pill until 1965 for married women and 1973 for single women. It was any form of birth control being talked about. These were the Comstock laws were not made illegal until this time. And so there was like these undercover words being used, like feminine hygiene product in the early 1900s that would mean birth control. Like every woman knew that the feminine hygiene product was going to prevent pregnancy. So products like Lysol were advertised as feminine hygiene products. And the number one form of birth control used during the Great Depression was Lysol.
Which is insane.
I hurt thinking about it, okay?
Woo! Think about how many women like became infertile from putting Lysol. All the medical implications. And we don't give birth control to men.
Right.
I'd like to see a man put Lysol. Shoot yeah. it up there.
Yeah. So, you know, these were the measures, and this was this lack of information. And
but to know where we were coming from and then to see this big turn that we just took in Texas mm-hmm. and to realize that there are things we can do. We do want to get the Equal Rights Amendment passed. That's a mm-hmm. huge way for us to start to be able to fight these kind of insane new, like this legislation that's occurring in different states. And the what's happening with the ERA right now, if for those of you who don't know, the Equal Rights Amendment is the shortest amendment that would ever be amended into the Constitution. And it states that you cannot discriminate on the basis of sex. And that's it. That's the whole amendment. That you cannot discriminate on the basis of sex. It's good for everyone. And so we now have ratified the Equal Rights Amendment, but we need to remove the deadline. We removed the deadline, I think, on March 17th of this year. I think it was the 17th. It's a big day for us. I should know it. I should get it tattooed on my forehead. And it passed in the House to remove the deadline, but it needs to pass in the Senate. And there are ways that we can help. You can go to the ERA Coalition website and you can, they make it so easy to write to your senators. They make it so easy to donate. They make it so easy to find grassroots action, sign petitions. So it's nice to know that there's something out there that you can do from your living room. And you can and help women advocate for each other and for yourself. And if you're a man and you're listening to this, we need you. We need you to call on behalf of us, on behalf of your mother, your sister, your love, your friend.
Exactly. That's
so important. Because one of the scary things about this new bill in Texas is it's also allowing people to sue each other. So you can sue somebody that aids in helping somebody get an abortion. You can sue the person that administers the abortion. You can sue the person that is going to have the abortion. And you do not need to be related in any way to the person that is having the abortion in order to do these things. And so now we're creating an even more isolating experience than it already is, and a more painful experience than it already is. And we are almost guaranteeing that this will be done in a dangerous way. Yeah. And that's so upsetting, and that should not happen to women or to anyone. Mm-hmm. So
I guess we'll wrap it up here.
And on that cheery, cheery note, but there are things that we can do, and there are ways that we can help each other. And I think even in this beautiful film festival here, being able to bring awareness to women and find unity is so important and for our survival and for the health.
What's great about the Repro Film Festival is, here's a place for you to get information.
Yes.
But you're getting information through art, so it's entertaining. And it's so important that we do have a place where we can discuss these issues and we can talk about them and we can personalize them, because they are personal. When we talk about them on a political level, sometimes we can disengage because it's like, not me personally, but we do deal with this. You know, over 50% of the population is women, and we deal with this every day. And so now we have a place where we can voice and we can express ourselves through art, and we can watch other people's art, and we can learn things. It's great. So we want to thank all of you guys for joining us and for getting involved in the movement and reproductive rights and reproductive justice for all. And please make plans to support the Repro Film Festival by purchasing film tickets or an all access pass, which is what I will be doing, so they can convert that money to donations to support the missions of this year's beneficiary organizations, which are Black Women's Health Imperative, The Lilith Fund, and No More Secrets. All 15 films included in the festival are directed by filmmakers who use she, her pronouns. And you can get full festival information at reprofilmfest.com. Thank you so much for tuning in, and many blessings. And thank you for Shea Carter for joining us.
Thank you for having me, and thank you for sharing in this amazing conversation. And I hope we spread empathy and compassion and acceptance. Bye, guys.